be loved and worshipped, but as an independent reality.
This is the one area in which he comes over as typical of his age. Victorian England was responsible for a terrifying amount of ugliness. In fact, it was the first epoch to let loose a real tidal wave of ugliness in our land. Sensitive, thoughtful Victorians saw what was happening as clearly as we can see it in retrospect. Their reaction took two forms, one secular, one religious. On its purely humanistic side, the reaction was known as the aesthetic movement. It was presided over here in Oxford by its great figurehead, Walter Pater. Pater derived his aesthetic doctrine from his lack of any overarching religious belief. Life, to him, was a series of more or less unrelated experiences. One's endeavor, therefore, should be to make the experiences themselves as perfect as possible. And experience, to Pater, meant aesthetic experience, the appreciation of the beautiful. His books had a tremendous influence on a whole generation of Oxford undergraduates, which included Oscar Wilde, the poet Swinburne, and a close friend of Hopkins at Balliol, Robert Bridges. 40 years after Hopkins's death, Bridges published his greatest single work. It's called The Testament of Beauty. So deep and so lasting was the influence of that cult on these young men. But for all that, Pater's humanism did not rub off on Gerard Hopkins. In the end, the decisive Oxford influence on him was not Pater or anyone resembling Pater.
July the 17th. It was this night that I saw clearly the impossibility of staying in the Church of England, but resolved to say nothing to anyone till 3 months are over.
The reaching out for beauty was not confined to the humanists. It formed an important ingredient in the wide-ranging program of the Anglo-Catholic Revival, or Oxford Movement, started in the 1830s by Keble and Pusey. This movement sought to irradiate Christian worship with the beauty of ritual, of stained glass and vestments, and of music. Inevitably, it was denounced by some Protestants as a subtle arm of the Roman Catholic Church, and there were always those in the movement who found that the impetus, once started up, took them all the way to Rome. The most notable convert was John Henry Newman, profound scholar, poet, saintly ascetic. In 1845, Newman had gone from the pulpit of this very university church, St. Mary's, to embrace the faith of the Vatican, after much inward struggle. The young Hopkins decided that he must follow the same path.
To the Reverend Dr. John Newman. Very Reverend Father, I have just heard from my father and mother in return for my letter announcing my conversion. Their answers are terrible. I cannot read them twice. They urge me with utmost entreaties to wait till I have taken my degree, more than half a year. This brings the matter to an absurdity and makes me think that any delay, whatever relief it may be to my parents, is impossible. I am asking you then whether I shall at all costs be received at once.
And so, under the personal inspiration of Newman, Hopkins was received into the Roman Catholic Church. It was 1866. Hopkins was 22. And this is where his dedicated, uncompromising nature came to the fore. Once he had decided that the Roman Catholic faith was for him, he entered a religious order and submitted himself entirely to its discipline. When he entered the Society of Jesus, he took all his poems and burnt them. It cost him a pang. He referred to it in his journal as the slaughter of the innocents. But to him at that time, this was the severe face of vocational discipline. "Don't call the Jesuit discipline hard," his mentor Newman told him in a letter. "It will bring you to heaven." For 8 years, Hopkins renounced his poetic for his priestly vocation. But this was before his mature vision of poetry and his mature gift for creating it had developed. Once they had, he understood and put into practice a relationship between poetry and prayer that made of them a seamless fabric. To contemplate what the Creator has done, to lose oneself in the awe and gratitude that come from seeing in their true nature the simplest, the most commonplace things, a leaf, a raindrop, the movement of cloud or water, the miracle of light at morning or evening, is to move towards that Creator. To value the beauty and the naked individuality of each thing that God has given us. This, Hopkins is always telling us in his poetry, is the beginning of wisdom. Pray for this first.
The world is charged with the grandeur of God. It will flame out like shining from shook foil. It gathers to a greatness like the ooze of oil, crushed.
It was when he came to read the work of the medieval English philosopher Duns Scotus that Hopkins began to understand that being a priest didn't mean giving up beauty or poetry.
"This air I gather and I release," he lived on. "These weeds and waters, these wars are what he haunted, who of all men most sways my spirits to peace."
Scotus had a theory of knowledge that laid stress on the final, irreducible selfhood of every created thing. To recognize a created object, he said, means recognizing not only the category to which it belongs, but its own totally individual essence, for which he used the term hikietas, thisness.
"Each mortal thing does one thing and the same. Selves, goes itself, myself it speaks and spells, crying, what I do is me, for that I came.